Welcome to this third lecture in the fourth theme in the software architecture course. We're talking about architecture patterns. Now it's time for a case study, Jeds Rental. Jed is running a business where he offers services to his customers to rent different hardware, power tools, etc. The case is adapted from Edward Brown. Here's a brief description. What's important now is that, Jed has been running this business for quite some time, and now his customer, for years, his customers have asked for opportunities or ways to arrange rentals using mobile devices and do things over the web, not having to go to Jeds to stores to rent the stuff. And now Jeds believe it's time to go for this. So if we look at the stakeholders and their concerns, we have Jed and Judy. Judy is running a store. She's a store manager. Jed is, the owner. And then we have Lisa, who's she's one of the customers. And here's some of the architectural significant requirements: functionality, of course, security, performance, usability, and cost. And for Lisa, she owns an event company. She has some concerns, and what's important here is quick responses, flexibility, and also some security, information security at the top. Then we have a development team, and you recognize this team from previous lectures. They are, of course, interested in maintainability. Maintainability is, how well does the system cope with change? So changes, maintainability is, maintenance, I should say, is corresponds to 90% or even more of the entire life cycle of a software system, and if you consider the more iterative and incremental style of developing software, you may argue that after the first iteration, your software is in a maintenance state, so you add, you perfect, etc. The features you already have in your system. But here's the team, and they are concerned with maintainability. Lisa, she was more concerned with in this case, performance. So architecture design, as we described it, using these five steps: pick a significant requirement, look for options in the knowledge, you find options, you make the decisions after the evaluation, and you document it in the views. Part of the knowledge, your own experience, of course, but also other systems and the patterns and reference architectures, tactics, etc., that we have in our books and binders and computers, of course. So if you look at performance and maintainability as the significant requirements here, what's important is that, remember from one of the from the previous lecture that a design pattern, in this case, which is the knowledge that we will consider, a pattern contributes to a concern or a requirement, but it may also work against another concern or requirement. So you need to trade. You need to trade off, and that's why we have this scale here in the process, that we take two requirements: performance, maintainability, and the architect will look for patterns, and they will find options, and they will evaluate the options and come up with the decisions where they trade something for something else to find a balance that is good enough for the system. So if you look at tactics for maintainability, you remember that patterns and tactics, or I should say tactics, are more like strategies to achieve certain qualities. Sometimes a pattern can be part of a strategy or a complete strategy. Tactics for maintainability, you see here on the left hand side that a change or changes arrive, and at the right hand side the outbound arrow is changes made, tested, deployed within time and budget. Well, that's a response of the system. But how do you achieve this? How do you get a system that can take care of these changes as they arrive, timely and within budget and with the expected quality that we get through testing? Well, there are a couple of strategies for modifiability or maintainability. And that is, first, well, to localize changes. So you should have what's known as single responsibilities that you don't spread a responsibility over multiple elements in your architecture. You should have allocated responsibilities to as few elements as possible. Doing that, well, you know that if you have to change something, the changes are local and you don't have to consider effects spread. And then the second one is that you should prevent ripple effects. That is, like, the effect of a change to one element shouldn't spread to other elements, nearby elements. And this can be achieved by interface hiding information, restrict communication paths, or, for instance, use an intermediary. Then we can also defer binding time, so you can wait with a decision until late in after compile time. You can have runtime registration, for instance. You can have configuration files, which is load time binding. You can have polymorphism, which is runtime. Polymorphism as what you know from object orientation, etc. So there are some strategies here, and what's important here is that if you look at these strategies, localized changes, prevent ripple effects, and defer the binding time, most of these can be achieved through certain patterns. For instance, some of the patterns you know from the book from the Gang of Four's book on design patterns for object-oriented systems. But as we all know that object orientation, when you have polymorphism, you have inheritance hierarchies, etc., you have dynamic binding, all these strategies add overhead. And adding overhead is something that we don't want, because in that situation we need to trade performance for maintainability. So the thing here is that can we find something that is good enough? And when we talk about patterns, well, we have Kirsten here on the left. She's really an advocate for microservices. She says that, well, that's nice. Kirsten says that, well, it will give us performance, it will give us maintainability at the same time. Great. Jed says, great, this is perfect. But then Steve here on the right-hand side, he said, no, let's go for service orientation. I really love that. We used that in a previous project. It was great. We had perfect control over the situation. So whenever a change occurred, well, it was straightforward operations for us to get the change into the system. So I really prefer service orientation to get maintainability. However, well, are any of these two good enough? Well, that's part of the evaluation, and we're not really there yet. But we know that, for instance, if you have a service orientation, you need registries, and that could mean that you have a lot of indirections. You could have indirections if you go for microservices too, because you have the API discovery. But on the other hand, mostly you have less overhead in a microservice architecture, because it's like coherent and comprehensive. So what we could see here is that, well, at the end of the day, We go for Kirsten's proposal. The option she advocates is the best one. So we come to architecture design, and well, here the best pattern for performance and maintainability is microservices. So, well, Steve and the rest of the gang, together with Kirsten, go forward and create an architecture which is based on four services. And for that, well, they could use a reference architecture, but, well, not necessarily. And then they had the fifth component, which is an API registry that can be used to register and look up services available in the system. So just to get a feeling for the role of patterns in architecture design, well, it's important because it provides options, but it also provides guidance for the elements you need, the responsibilities the elements have, and also how to organize them. And as you will see later, you can also use reference architectures to expand this and get an even bigger picture of systems like this. So that was a very short but simple example of how we work with Jeds Rental and how Kirsten and Steve negotiated, discussed if they should go for a microservice architecture or more traditional service-oriented architecture. And at the end of the day, Kirsten managed to convince the rest of the gang and that microservice architecture is the best fit for what they need, and that means that they can satisfy Lisa's requirements on performance and the development team's requirement on maintainability. And now it's time to move on to the fourth and final lecture on reference architectures.